Allies of President Trump are trying to raise millions of dollars to target journalists.
According to a report by Axios' Mike Allen, the group claims that it will give damaging information about reporters and editors to, quote, friendly media outlets like Breitbart. The idea is to punish reporting that, in their view, makes the president look bad. So Sara Fischer is a media reporter for Axios. Just went through this article, and this is really unprecedented, and I feel like I've never heard of anything like this happening before. But Sara, what are these Trump allies trying to do by targeting reporters that they think are unfairly covering the president?
Well, if you talk to them, they'll say that they are trying to sort of balance out coverage. They think that the president is unfairly covered by what they call the mainstream media. And so their thought process here is that if they can dig up old tweets or opposition research on journalists and editors, that they can undermine some of their reporting. Now, the only problem there is that takes a lot of resources. And that's why Axios' Mike Allen had a big scoop today when he found out that they're trying to raise $2 million to create an operation that will be able to do this. I think what I'm watching to see is the Trump sort of support network going to take this effort seriously? And if you look at what he gets traction of online, I would guess they probably will. If this group is able to unearth an old tweet from a journalist that's a little bit damning, you can expect the Trump network to really elevate it.
So I guess one question I have, is it legal?
I mean, it's not illegal, but it's not right either. I think that's the big moral conundrum that we're having here. I mean, you are allowed, a lot of campaigns hire opposition researchers all the time. However, they typically do it for the opponent of the candidate, not the media. But that's not how Trump works. If you notice, Trump's 2016 strategy was never to really punch too hard at Democrats. Sure, he gave some of them nicknames and made fun of them, but that was not his strategy. His strategy has always been to bully the refs, whether that's a social media companies claiming that they have conservative bias, or if it's the mainstream media claiming that they don't cover him fairly. Heck, he's gone after courts saying that the legal process doesn't support him. Trump's strategy has always been to bully the refs. So even if this is technically legal, which it is, does it mean that it's right? I mean, that's the bigger question.
Yeah, I mean, he's called the media the enemy of the people, you know, on more than one occasion. So, yeah, this is sort of part of his strategy. So how does this play into his repeated attacks on the media, but also his relationship with the press?
It's such a complicated relationship. We know that Donald Trump loves to elevate media reports that are good to him or that prove a point he's trying to make. And he loves to bash the ones that don't. I'll give you a good example. A few weeks ago, Axios' Jonathan Swan reported that the president was considering using nuclear weapons to combat hurricanes. The president didn't like that, and he tweeted out something negatively about Axios. Less than a few days later, he tweeted out one of our articles sort of praising the idea. I think the deal here with President Trump is this. If you give him coverage that he likes, he's going to elevate it. If you give him coverage he doesn't like, he's not. He's going to bash it. But at the end of the day, the most important thing he can do is create an opposition that is the media or any sort of information gatekeeper instead of going after the Democrats as his opposition directly. I think that's his real big strategy here.
You know, Sara, and you're well aware of this, the president, as Emery pointed out, has attacked the press repeatedly. It's unprecedented in American history. Politicians and journalists generally do not get along, but the idea of using language that has been used by authoritarian dictators in the past in the United States is just something that we've never really seen before. What is the strategy here? Because it does feel as if the president is essentially trying to get people to say, hey, don't believe your lying eyes. Don't believe the things that you hear. Don't believe the things that you see. Only believe me. So that's how you get an interview on another network where a representative of the Republican Party who represents the president's campaign goes on television and is directly asked, has the president ever lied? And that person says no. And essentially, yeah, believe me. Don't believe the press. Don't believe other people who disagree with me.
One of the best things I've heard was someone wrote an article basically saying that the future of privacy is disinformation, meaning that what the president's strategy here is, you can't target him with correct information or you can't target him with valid perspective if he's going to just flood the zone with chaos, whether that's truth, whether that's lies. He just wants to flood the zone with chaos. And part of that is creating chaos around media, saying that they're the fake news, don't listen to them. But then when it is something that benefits him, elevating that media. And so I think the way to look at this is President Trump doesn't have the most targeted media strategy. His only strategy is to create chaos and confusion, because that helps, quite frankly, obfuscate any sort of real facts. The other thing I'd mention here, too, is that he has one of the most impassioned online support groups out of any candidate. I mean, the Trump 2020 support network is so fervent on not only like fringe right platforms, but even mainstream platforms like Twitter. And when he goes after the mainstream media, it creates a huge ripple effect of buzz that helps elevate the president. That's why he does these attacks as well, is it creates this sort of buzz network that he thinks is going to help push him through into 2020. And, you know, I want to say, oh, that's crazy, that wouldn't work. But I think that helped him a lot in 2016. And so I think I understand why he's doubling down on the strategy ahead of 2020.
There have been studies that have been done, Sarah, as you know, that people take greater pleasure in owning the libs than they do in seeing their dwindling pocketbooks because of policies that are put into place that might have a detrimental effect on them, as we look at the market down today significantly.
Mm-hmm. Listen, before we let you go, I want to ask you one more question on a totally different topic. Andrew Yang, right? The title of the article, the Axios article, is Andrew Yang Gets Media Cold Shoulder. And essentially, a lot of his supporters, Yang Gangs, right? That's what they're called, are complaining that he's not getting as much coverage as some of the other Democratic contenders here. There are a lot, and it is difficult for everyone to sort of get their say. But explain what the article's about and what's happening.
Well, I'm glad that you asked about this, because it ties into what we were just talking about. If you take a look at how Andrew Yang is polling and how his online support is growing, you would have no idea that he's polling in the top, he's polling in the top six. He's just not getting the type of cable news coverage. He's not getting the type of digital online article coverage. And I think it just kind of points to a greater trend of the media doesn't necessarily know how to cover such an unconventional candidate. But that's why when you hear someone like Donald Trump ripping the media for having bias, that's why those attacks sort of carry weight, because you have some concrete examples, like the one we reported on this morning, where sometimes the media isn't giving enough coverage to a candidate that actually does have grassroots support. So you can see how both trends sort of tie in here, and it's going to make for a messy 2020 media landscape.
Just like to point out that CBSN, over the course of our existence, has done very often interviews with people who are running for office, who the mainstream, the larger cable networks specifically, do not give a lot of credence to. In fact,
including Andrew Yang.
Andrew Yang, and it was Tanya Rivera who interviewed Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez when she was still a very long shot candidate for Congress. And so if you're out there listening, come on.
We got
you covered over here. Sara Fischer, always great to talk to you. Love having you on the show. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.